Hey Gear Seekers, I'm Nick. This is my music production PC, the one I've been using for about, I'm gonna say 18 months now. I've been the same hardware for a long time. However, some parts in this I wanna upgrade. There's other parts that don't need to be this powerful. So what I'm gonna do today is something that was kind of inspired by the Leon Lee and the Dan Case A4H2O. Which is, if you haven't seen our video, click it in the description now. I want to use this for my music production PC case. And if you don't know, I like small form factor PCs for this use case. And this will look really, really nice on my desk. So I'm going to build myself, it's not new, but it's going to be a different music production PC so I can make all the music. Hello, Bindi. You coming through, mate? This video is part of our Build With Me series, basically where I sit down, have a chat with you guys, and walk you through my thought process with the parts that I choose for my personal PC build. So let's harvest, we just need the memory, gonna harvest the RAM out of this, and I'm gonna build something relatively fresh in the A4H2O. Let's do it. The main reason for this switch is I've been making quite a bit of music on this system, which is basically it's all it's used for, but the AIO in it is making a bit of a weird sound, well, the pump is at least, and these AIOs with the pumps and the radiators, I just don't trust them. I've never had great experience with them, and the thermals, it's getting quite hot, and I don't want it to generate much heat while I'm trying to chill and make beats. I don't want to have to think about the computer that I'm making music on. The GPU is a 3060. I do not need a 3060 in a music production PC. I have no idea why I put a 3060 in it. It doesn't need exceptional graphics performance. It's a really pointless GPU for this machine. Not only that, this is the only 3060 I have. So I haven't been able to do any builds with any 3060 since I put this machine together. I'm gonna pull that out. I'm gonna use it for some builds. I have a few 6600 XTs and I know this is a nice problem to have, but a GPU that I've got a few of, and something that I'm not gonna miss if it's in a permanent PC is this. This is the ASUS Dual 6600 XT. The machine doesn't need exceptional graphics performance, as I mentioned, but I don't have anything less than this. I'm not gonna miss this, to be fair. The reality is I'd either give this away to friends or family, or I'm gonna use it for something that benefits everyone, and that's in my music production PC, because if you didn't know, we make all the music and you can get it by clicking that join button down below. So yeah, I need something. I just really don't want to offend anyone, because anytime I talk about using a GPU for a personal rig, I get attacked. But this is a PC that I actually really need to have. But as a bit of a refresher on the overall specs of this, this is running the Intel Core i5-10600K, a 3060. It's running the B560 iBoard from MSI, the Gaming Edge Wi-Fi, and it's got a 2 terabyte NVMe M.2. That's another thing I'm changing in this system. It's just too much storage, I don't need it. Everything that I do music production wise is over the network, so I don't need that much storage. Which leads me to the new hardware. I'm basically using hardware for this that I'm not gonna be using for anything else ever again, because it's run its course on the channel with content and stuff. So the CPU I'm gonna be using is the Intel Core i5-11600K. The main reason why I picked this over a Ryzen chip is because of the motherboard, believe it or not. I don't have very many AM4 ITX boards at the moment, and the one that I do have has the one feature that I want, but it doesn't fit nicely in here. And I only have one 5600X and I need to keep that for builds for the time being. So the 11600K is one of the least used CPUs that I've ever used. And I think I maybe only used it 3 or 4 times, if that. So it's gonna go into this machine here. The motherboard that I went with is something that we were using for our kernel control PC that I pulled apart. I didn't do it on video. I pulled the BIND 11700K off this board here, which is the Z590i Vision board from Gigabyte. The chip from this went over to the guys at Struthless Studios for their new animation PC. And when I pulled that chip off this board, I was thinking to myself, I should probably use this for my music production PC, for one feature.
It's got two Thunderbolt 4 ports,
and there is some outboard gear that I'm looking at to get in the future that uses Thunderbolt for music production. So it'll be good just to have this here and for it to be accessible. A lot of music production gear is macOS and Apple centric, and this kind of opens the door to that Apple centric stuff that can be quite cool and stuff that I can use in Windows too. And lastly, for the storage, I'm just gonna go for this 1 terabyte FireCuda 520 PCIe Gen 4 drive. It's not the fastest one. It's not even close to being the fastest. It used to be one of the fastest a couple years ago, and I haven't used this for a while. I had this sitting on a storage card that I decommissioned from one of our servers. And lastly, the case, the A4H2O from Leon Lee and Dan case. When we did our video, which you can check out down below in the description, I fell in love with this case for a few reasons. The size, the way it looks, and this will be one of the only computers that I use that's going to sit on my desk because it just looks so clean and it just suits my aesthetic and my vibe basically. I love it. It looks really cool. I need to pull the RAM out of this machine and I need to pull the RAM out. I'm literally just gonna do it like this. I'm gonna come back and decommission this whole system properly, but for now, I'm gonna be as jank as possible. God, I hate doing it from this angle. Ugh, I feel like I'm gonna smash stuff. Come on, baby. You know you wanna come out. Don't do this, guys. Do not remove hardware like that. Do not do what I'm doing right now. Okay. We've got our 32 gigs of RAM out, and I'm gonna tear this down another day off camera, because not really important right now. If you're new to PC building, this order isn't particularly important, but I usually do things a certain way because it's just me, right? I usually start off with socketing the CPU. I'm gonna be blocking the shot a little bit because of my hand. I'm sorry in advance. It's just how we have the camera set up, but now we should be good. And we just socket it. Right, all good, CPU's in. I'll do M.2 now. I did tear this down quite quickly the other day, so I don't know if anything's actually on here. I don't remember. Nothing in there. It's got another standoff that goes on a standoff. You'll have the M.2 standoff, right? And then the drive will sit in nice and flush, like on an even level. And then you'll need to put another standoff in. I'm just doing this as quickly as possible because this is our second video that we're filming for the day. Drop that back on there. Now M.2's in and RAM. That's it. We're almost ready, ladies and gents. I just need to put this top heatsink back on. Not that it really matters, but you know, it looks cool, right? It looks cool. That's the most important part. Looking cool. Isn't that what computers are all about? If there's anything you want to know about the A4H2O, as I mentioned, we did a full review of this whenever it launched a couple days ago, or whenever that was. I don't quite remember. I don't know when you're watching this, so whatever, right? So go and check that video out if you want to know every little detail, because we did cover everything. Pulling the top panel off because we're going to be liquid cooling this. And this case is pretty good for its size. I think it's 11.1 liters and it supports 240mm AIOs, which is brilliant. And I'm gonna be using the same AIO that I used in our review video because I know it fits and I've got two of them, so I won't miss like using it in this. I'm thinking I'm going to use a Cooler Master 750 watt SFX power supply. I've got a few of them from just collecting them basically. So if I were to use one in this machine, I wouldn't miss it too much. One of the biggest complaints with this board that people have had is it doesn't have front panel audio connectors. For me personally, this is not a deal breaker because I use all outboard gear anyway, so it makes no difference to me. But if you're using this board and you want to use the front panel audio, I would skip this board completely. Because, yeah, it just doesn't have that connector on the board. One of the complaints with this case that I saw with some reviews is you couldn't put the motherboard screw in this bottom corner. Well, that's not true, because look at that. This case has a bit of a weird building order, because the next thing we need to do is actually put the cooler in so we can make everything else fit around that, because the tubes do in fact get in the way quite a bit. So let's make this fit like we did with the original build. The four screws in for the top rad. Always a debate with thermal paste, and there always will be, but I found over my many years of experience for these Intel IHSs, just a P dot directly in the center will be more than enough. Another handy little tip I like to do, especially when making builds clean, is I like to put the cables underneath the brackets like this, and it doesn't touch the cold plate at all, and it's not going to melt, so you don't need to freak out about that. Yeah, it's just putting the cables underneath so they're nice and clean. And when we plug it in, you don't really see anything. So mount that up now. Give it a little bit of a wiggle. This is an awkward angle to be doing this on, but it's a good way to film and a good way for you guys to learn some stuff. So we'll do one lightly on that corner, lightly on this corner. And I think this is the way I had the hoses oriented in the build. A lot of videos that I saw, people had issues with getting them to come out at the bottom. I did not have such issues. It's just a bit of fandangling, and you can make anything fit the right way. Just check that's nice and firm. And then we'll just plug it into this header up the back here. I'm not putting the included pump top cover on because it doesn't matter. I'm never going to be looking inside this thing. We'll put the GPU in now because we can actually remove this panel here to get access and fix up the cable management later. So it's not a big deal if we drop it in now. A lot of the time with these small form factor builds, I actually like to plug in a bunch of the power cables first and then route them after, because it does make it easier depending on the case. Usually the EPS power cable will go in, 24 pin power connector. As you can see, it's quite anemic with the amount of cables required for this build. There's absolutely nothing really. It's EPS cable, 24 pin power cable, and one to power the GPU, and that's it. And then I would also recommend plugging in the actual power cable that was the pass-through cable, and then we can figure out how this is all gonna fit. So I think what we're going to do here is just put that one at the backside. The last thing we need to do now is plug in the GPU power cable, and we don't need to do much cable management because there isn't a lot going on with this case, to be fair. Building with this case, I found that it's better to do it in the order that I did. Otherwise, you'll just be losing your mind trying to get that power supply to fit in later, because now all we need to do is feed this back through like this and plug in the GPU power. Like that. The final pre-flight check I like to do when I build any small form factor PC, or any PC, mind you, is to check if there's any obstructions in the fans. The easiest way to do this is quite literally spin the fans, see if they spin or not, and we're all good to go. Overall, I'm pretty happy with the cable management here. Everything looks relatively clean on the motherboard side, which is good, because if I need to get access to anything here, it's going to be an absolute breeze. I purposely picked a motherboard that doesn't have any storage on the back, so that would just be an absolute pain. And it's actually another reason why I didn't pick the ASRock board with Thunderbolt and the AM4 board, because if anything happened, I'd have to pull the whole board out and would have just been a complete nightmare. If we look on the GPU side, it's a little less clean, but it's functional. You're not gonna have any issues with it powering up. A last little pre-flight check to see that nothing's in those fans is not going to be. And we can put the panels back on. And put the thumb screws from the case back in. And that's it. My new music production PC is built. Now it's time to test it. It's the next day and we did some thermal testing. So let's quickly take a look at the results from that. What you're seeing on your screen right now is the system actually runs quite cool. However, just take into account that this type of testing for this type of system is on the extreme end. This system will never be pushed to 100% of anything, whereas all the components with these tests are pushing it to the limit. So the maximum that I saw when I was working on an audio project was probably around 45 degrees on the CPU, and the GPU temperature was the same as the idle temp, considering it doesn't do anything with the GPU when we're producing music. So I just thought that was a little bit of an interesting note. As far as acoustics with the system is dead silent. It's completely pointless to measure it because you quite literally cannot hear the system at all. I have everything in the BIOS set to silent, including the AIO pump. When we did the thermal testing and everything ramped up, you could only just hear the pump and the fans. It was audible. However, when I'm working on music, the system is dead silent. And that's exactly the point of using hardware like this. And this is the reason why I don't like to use overkill hardware for music production, because for the type of music that I produce, I don't need it. I don't need a million different VST instruments at the same time. I don't need a million effects. I don't need the fastest CPU in the world. I need something that can handle it, and I need something with lots of RAM. And that's basically what you should look at if you're building a music production PC. For home use and music production at home, you should look at more practical options. For me personally, when I'm planning out a music production PC, there's a few things I look at. The first thing is the CPU. I usually go for anything above a quad core, so like 4 to 6 cores. It's fine for music production. You're not gonna have any problems with a 10400, a 10600K, an 11600K, 11400, 12400, all that will be just fine. And on the AMD side, you can go 2600, 3600X, 5600X. You can even get away with one of the 1600s as well. So one of the questions we get asked the most about music production on the channel is, what software do you use? For me personally, I don't think that is very important. It's basically dependent on whatever you're comfortable with and what you can learn the fastest. For me personally, I've moved between Pro Tools, FL Studio, and Cubase over the years. At the moment, FL Studio is the quickest for me to make stuff because I don't have time to mess around too much, but I know the program inside out. I've been using it since the late 90s, so you can see that I'm playing this track in the background. This is the session for one of the latest songs that you've seen that we've used on build videos. And yeah, and I'm, see? The software is whatever you're comfortable with and whatever you can understand the easiest. For instance, I don't like Ableton. I don't like the workflow, but that might be different for you. I'm not the type of person who's gonna shame anyone for using their DAW of choice. For me personally, again, because of what I know and what I've been using since the 90s, FL Studio or Fruity Loops back then. Not only do we get asked about the software that we use, but also some of the audio gear that we use. I've actually downsized all of the gear that I use for music production, basically to save space. And so I don't feel so cluttered when I'm trying to do things. So I used to have a 61 keys Novation keyboard that was in here for a while. I got rid of it a while ago. I mean, I still own it. If we move house, I'm gonna build out a full studio. Don't get me wrong. So I will keep it, but I did purchase a Native Instruments A25. It's just a small little 25 keys MIDI controller. The thing I like about this MIDI controller is it's not too expensive. So I think I paid around just over 200 Aussie dollars for it, but there are some community driven projects on GitHub that allow you to integrate it with FL Studio. So I can control the whole program without touching my mouse and keyboard, which is something that I really like with music production. I don't need to think of the computer as a music production computer. I just think of it as a display for this control surface, right? The keynote out there who've been subscribed for a while would have noticed that I used to have a Prezonos AR12C mixer, a full 12 channel USB audio interface. That was a mixer, preamps, everything, you name it, it had it. I've had 5 of them now. And that actually died again, which is just bad luck with Prezonos stuff. So I'm not gonna be buying any more Prezonos stuff. What I ended up doing was it died around Black Friday and it was like the universe saying, hey, you know, it's dead. You need to buy something new. So I ended up going with the Focusrite Scarlett 8i6 Gen 3. Instead of having that big 12 channel interface, I've just got a regular audio interface now and it does everything I need it to do. I use it for voiceovers. It doesn't have the best preamp in the world. I had a microphone tube preamp that I was using for like 15 years, but last year or the year before, I can't remember, it decided to die. So I'm putting some money aside now to buy a new preamp for the mic. Headphones to me aren't super important for music production. I don't like wearing them for extended periods of time because I get fatigue pretty easily from headphones. So I'll only use headphones if I'm tracking vocals or recording some voiceovers. So what I use for monitoring audio, and I use these for editing as well, because this desk setup has a full KVM setup so I can switch between my two PCs. I use Genelec 8010As. I was using those Presonus Aeruses that we did a review about a couple years ago, but they also died, you know, classic Presonus stuff here. So I ended up investing in some very, very good studio monitors. Not only that, I've got a JBL sub on the floor as well, which rattles the windows if I turn it up too much. So this setup's all well and good, right? But this whole side of my office in April is getting completely rebuilt. OmniDesk is hooking us up with one of their new standing desks that isn't out yet. Don't even know if I can talk about this, but I'm gonna be converting this to a sit stand setup with all the music production stuff. So if I wanna stand up and do whatever or edit videos and make music or whatever, standing up or sitting down, I'm gonna have options. So we'll talk about all of that in April whenever it happens, but make sure if you wanna grab anything from OmniDesk, use our code GearSeekers in the description down below and grab yourself a discount. Not sponsored by OmniDesk, but like they're absolute legends, so I figured I'd just give them a shout out. Okay, now I wanna talk a little bit about some other testing that we attempted to do. So we've used DawBench in the past. Basically what it is it uses Reaper and it tests effects and contact instances and everything just to choke up your machine all the way. It's a pretty unrealistic benchmark in terms of sessions and what you'd actually be using. However, when we ran DawBench 2021 R2 on this machine, it broke all of our VSTs because we have so many. And I actually had to get the old machine. I had to then reclone the drive because it broke everything. And yeah, we're back and running again. So what I might do later is I want to talk a little bit more about music production in another video because you guys have been asking about it. I'll redo DawBench on a clean Windows install so we don't have any of those problems on this machine. It's pretty easy to pull the M.2 out, which is why I built it this way. But yeah, I thought I'd just share that with you as to why I didn't include any DawBench benchmarks. In fact, the reason why I'm filming this the next day, and you can usually tell if I'm wearing a different shirt, it's because it broke, because I spent hours last night trying to fix it. And I just was like, you know what, this is just not worth it. I'm just wasting time. And I want to share with you guys what ended up happening with this machine. So yeah, it turned out really good. The performance is amazing. It's quiet, it's cool, and it does everything I wanted to do. So I hope you guys enjoyed building with me. And if you guys like the music you heard here, you can get it by clicking that join button down below. And if you haven't subscribed yet, make sure you hit that button right now. Hit the like button and all that stuff. And to get early access to videos like this one, head on over to Floatplane. Once again, thank you so very much for watching. I'm your boy Nick with Gear Seekers. You peak, we seek. And I hope you enjoyed this little bit of, I don't know, it's a bit more creative than usual. So yeah, thanks for watching. See ya.